Well, good afternoon. Thanks for staying around to the end of the day. I was thinking I might be talking to an empty room by now. I'm going to talk about really three things today, and then hopefully we'll have time for a little bit of question and answer and be happy to give you some insight. What I was asked to discuss is a little bit about our company, why we are what we are, how we got there, what we're doing, and sort of a broad-based view of the profile, if you will, of a commercial company in aerospace and space. From one that started from grassroots, an entrepreneurial company, one that has built up over the years and has seen all the good, the bad, and probably made every mistake known to business, and probably a few of them several or three times just to make sure. So we're going to talk a little bit about that. Then I'm going to discuss what we're doing in our orbital space vehicle program, because I think there's a lot of interest in that, and we're pretty proud of our efforts there. But mainly I wanted to finish up and talk about the idea of partnerships. We've heard a lot of stuff today and probably over the next couple of days of how disjointed things are in our industry. And I guess I'm liking to be a contrarian. I've been a contrarian all my life. I invest in things that other people don't do. It's part of the reason why I got into commercial space, I think. But I don't think things are that bad. I actually think this is a pretty good time. And we're really excited about where we are and where the industry can be. And maybe to end the day up on a positive note, I'm pretty optimistic about the future, and I'll try to explain a little bit why. A little bit about our company. We've been around quite a long time in some form or another. We actually were formed in the 1960s, and we've been under the same leadership since the 1990s, or a little over 2,100, almost 2,200 people now. And what's a bit unusual about us is that we're owned and run by the people who are managing the company. We have no outside ownership. We don't have any banks. We don't owe any money. And that means that we're able to make some pretty good long-term decisions. And long-term decisions in space and aerospace is probably the thing that makes a company more as successful as possible. Many companies have to go look and make decisions based on quarterly earnings or stockholders' reports. We have that luxury where we're able to do a little things a little bit differently. And part of that has also been fueled by the fact that we've been averaging a very strong growth rate for a long time. And we make money at what we do. We're pretty hard on making decisions. We make decisions pretty difficult decisions all the time. And some things we don't do, and we even though we might want to do them because they're not the right thing to do. All that means that we wind up having some money at the end of the year. And unlike a lot of companies that have to go out and pay off investors or pay off banks, we take all that money and put it back into business. And that means that we carry about twice the average IR&D rate. Investment rate into new projects, some of which are very visible projects like our Dream Chaser. We've been in space now about 22 years, and our first launch was in 1989, and we've been on over 400 missions, 410 missions as of a couple of days ago, and about 4,000 things we've built have gone to space, which means at the end of the day we know how hard it is. It's a very difficult thing to do. And we have a great appreciation when we say we're going to go and do orbital space transportation. It's not coming out of a whim. It's coming out of a lot of hard thought. We're sending something to space now on the average of about every 3 weeks. Many things that we do, we're the largest small satellite maker in the United States, one of the largest component builders for spacecraft in the United States. And we have other products, which I'll go into briefly, but we really understand how difficult it is to be an aerospace and space company from a perspective of a bunch of people who operate and run the business and own the business. Next slide. Before I get into space, just to give you a sense, we are the largest converter of aircraft for the U.S. government. What that means is that we take common standard airplanes and we turn them into special mission airplanes for surveillance, for intelligence, for weather fighting, for border monitoring. We have a fleet now over 250, almost 260 airplanes flying around the world. And you can go to the next slide. And airplanes, UAVs, next slide. And what we call aerostats or altitude, high altitude balloons. Next slide. And in doing all that, one of the interesting things that have come out of that is that we have an FAA certification to be a safety organization. We're able to fix and monitor our own planes, which means we've developed a longstanding relationship with the FAA. And as we get into space transportation, FAA is going to be an important part of this. We think it should be. We think that George and his team are doing a terrific job in trying to balance the government need and understanding that there's a market here. But coming from the perspective of someone who's going to operate an orbital transportation system, we understand and know and have relationships with not only NASA, but FAA, who's going to be a major component of this. We also get to do some really interesting projects that are all related, eventually all come back to space. This is a picture of a sitting above a helicopter that's trying to land in Iraq. And if you're imagining it, you're the medevac helicopter pilot who's trying to get through that, which is a sandstorm. They have major sandstorms there that you can't see through. We were asked to solve that problem, and we did with a synthetic vision system that allows the pilot to see through the sand and land, which has reduced accidents for about 30% out there. And if you can imagine, not only is there a problem of the helicopters coming through this and trying to land, but oftentimes they have injured soldiers on board. So that pilot is even more interested in getting that helicopter on the ground. Next slide. We're involved in doing telemedicine, which has become a really fascinating field. And basically what this means is pushing the information to help a soldier all the way out in the field from the time that the medic gets there to all the way to when they get to the major air hospital. Next slide. And we do that around the world. We have licenses and operations throughout the world now in about 25 countries. Next slide. In the space area, we have four things going on. We are a satellite builder. We look at small satellites, which in our mind is 1,000 kilograms, 700 kilogram and less. And currently, we're the largest manufacturer of those in the United States. We have a technology business, which means we build hardware for most of the major prime contractors who do geosats and planetary missions. And most of what we do in that area is mission critical. It means that if we build it and it doesn't work, then there's a very big problem for a lot of programs. We have a propulsion group which specializes in various types of rocket motors and satellite propulsion systems. And then most recently, 2 years ago, we stood up a space exploration group which is focused in on doing orbital space transportation. Next slide. The variety of kinds of things we do, and one of the reasons I put this slide up is because I think that we all talk about the big value, big mission programs and forget that most of those things are enabled by pretty small things. And those small things have to work, and there are sometimes 10, 20,000 different parts in a big spacecraft. We build working, moving, electrical, mechanical parts for programs that become high-profile programs. Next slide. And these are some of those kinds of programs. The Mars rovers, which as a mission program, we were told to expect a six-month mission with a one-year outside life, and we're now going on well into the seventh year on one of the rovers and 6 years on the other. We've been involved with doing many other high-profile programs like that. Next slide. Some of you, I don't know how many of you have had the opportunity to stand next to a very big GEO satellite. This is an example of what it looks like, and it's an advanced CHF satellite that was just launched that's going to carry defense communication for around the world. We built the devices that moved all the antennas for which this satellite would not work if those antennas didn't move properly. Next. And we are a major provider to a critical system for the Mars Science Lab, which is going to launch in this November. The green thing you see in the corner is the descent braking system. Any of you have seen the profile of this, it's a unique, very unique system that will come down, and we're monitoring and maintaining the rate of descent for the system as it lands on Mars, which means that I have about 10 minutes of terror someday in November when there's about 8 minutes to send the signal and about 2 minutes to carry out the maneuver and then 8 minutes to come back. And during that period of time, we sit there and wonder, did this actually work or not? And it's those kind of moments that you realize that you really do need to build this stuff pretty well. Next. Small satellites are go for us from, I like to talk about them in refrigerator size, washing machine size, microwave size, for those of you who aren't in the satellite business. And we build that class of satellites on very different platforms. And what's most interesting about this is that we're becoming a pretty big builder of this. And all the things that I've talked about will somehow relate back into orbital transportation. We think that there's a servicing business in space for an orbital transportation system. And if we are a builder of a lot of small satellites to go to LEO and have the ability to go service that, that's a market that we can self-manage and actually provide as an extra opportunity for our clients. Next. We've been involved in doing rocket motors for a long time, and we've had the pleasure and privilege of being engaged with the Virgin Galactic team and the Scaled Composites team on the Spaceship Two program, doing a variety of motors in that vein. Very high profile and a very exciting program, and one that we all, I think, should pay homage to the people involved with it, because it's one of those groundbreaking things that bring a lot of interest to new space in a positive way. Next. On our commercial crew development program, you can go to the next slide. We didn't just come to this game. We started working on this program now almost 7 years ago. And as somebody said earlier, and you'll see in a few minutes, that this was not something that we started on our own. We picked up a program that had a long life with NASA called the HL-20, and made a number of major changes to the program, but also kept a lot of the philosophy and research that had gone in that. We labored for about 4 years on our own. We lost a couple times as we were trying to get money to go forward with this program, and then finally we had an unfunded Space Act agreement for a while, which people thought I was crazy when I signed originally. And so why would you want to go through all the problems of having an agreement with NASA where you got monitored and you had program reviews where they paid you no money? And when we looked at it, I said that the reason is because someday I think we're going to win and we're going to have a lot of discipline in managing this process, and we will have access to NASA. We will know what they need to do. So when it becomes time for us to actually do it for real, we would not be starting up. And it actually turned out that way. It was a very, very important thing. We did 8 milestones unfunded, and we moved the program forward, and NASA got to know us, and we got to know them. It was a very productive activity for us. Then 2 years ago, we entered and won the first round of the CCDEV competition. We won the largest award of that round. It produced 4 milestones, and we completed them all on time. We actually self-volunteered, added a 5th milestone to the mix, which you want to have people go crazy. You go back to the government and say, well, by the way, we finished all our milestones. We want to add one. There wasn't a mechanism for figuring out how to add something like that, so it was a lot of fun for us. And our view in this program is that it's something that we co-contribute to, not only in terms of money, which we did, but also in terms of having a very open attitude. We enjoy the relationship with NASA. We were open to it. We think we learned a lot from it. We continue to learn a lot from it. And it was a very successful program for us, which we built real hardware, as you'll see in a minute. And then earlier this year, we were fortunate enough to be a participant and then a winner in the CCDEV 2 competition, which we're now actively engaged in. There are 9 milestones over the course of about a year and a half, and we just finished our 3rd milestone. We're on actually ahead of schedule and moving very quickly in that program. Next slide. Our launch system is the Atlas V. And although we're agnostic, we can launch on anything that could lift our mass. We chose this for a variety of reasons. Once we were actually the first commercial agreement that ULA signed, and we got into it before ULA actually got going. So we've been working with them now for over 5 years. And what we did is what we do in most of our programs. We sat down and we said, what's the toughest question we could ask? And the toughest question we could ask is, could you fly this vehicle on top of your rocket? And if that was a non-starter, then we either didn't have a program or we had to go look for somewhere else. And we spent almost 2 years very quietly working on that. And we came to the conclusion that not only could we do it, but it was a very simple, elegant way to make that happen. And we chose the Atlas because it has the capacity to do what we do, but mainly because it has a long history. The Atlas program has had almost 100 launches. The Atlas V now has been launched over 25 times, and it will have launched over 40 times by the time we send humans on board. And I have to tell you, since I'm going to be on this vehicle at some point, I'd rather be flying a vehicle and be on top of something that's flown all that time. And when you go up to the Atlas and you look at it and you ask the question, you ask, do you know what's on top of you? It has no difference between a large GEO satellite that costs billions of dollars and a Dream Chaser 25,000 pounds. The rocket works, and it works well, and it's a U.S. asset, and we know what we have a lot of history with it. On top of that, it's also had the experience of flying the X-37 with Boeing recently, which is a very similar kind of vehicle. So we're very pleased with the relationship and the work together, and we asked all and answered all the tough questions early on. You'll notice we're top-mounted, which avoids a number of issues, and we have learned and benefited from all the experiences from the shuttle program. Next. We're building hardware, and this is not a theoretical game for us. The first flight vehicle is now well into production. We're expecting to do our first atmospheric test with the vehicle about this time next year. It's moving along very quickly. What you see here is the primary structure, and this was now many months ago, but it was built and tested. Next slide. We have completely tested the rocket motors. One of the main additives that we did to the NASA HL20 program was we put propulsion on board. And by doing that, we solved 3 very big issues. The first is that we now have an onboard abort system for us. We don't need a separate abort for the vehicle, and it's a pusher abort as opposed to a puller abort. And by doing that, we actually are able to fly the vehicle off in any kind of emergency and land it. It's a runway landing vehicle. So all within the same system, we have that done. But assuming we don't have an issue on the pad and we go forth, we actually have what's called no black zones. From the time we launch all the way to orbit, we can abort to a landing, and by virtue of having onboard propulsion, we have the ability to choose a landing field. Unlike the shuttle, which has to go in a place and go land, we actually have the ability to have about a 1,000-mile cross range. So if I'm pointed at Florida, I can get to Atlanta. And we can land on any runway, virtually any runway. It takes only about 10,000 feet, which is any commercial runway in the world. So it's a very, very safe vehicle from the perspective of there isn't any place from when we start to when we get to orbit or when we come back that we can't find a flat landing field somewhere and land. And that's a really good thing. We've fully tested the motors for the full profile of the flight and made that one of the milestones which we passed with NASA. The milestone that we added last year was we actually built a large-scale model of the vehicle and fully outfitted it, including with cameras, and working with our partner, NASA Dryden. We flew it from 14,000 feet several times out in Mojave, and it flew, landed, we got the data, and are now working on learning from that experience what we need to do with the full-scale vehicle. Next. Most recently, we've done a number of things, but as of a week ago, one of our milestones was to build and to evaluate and test a full-scale flight simulator for the vehicle, which we now have. And it's I tell you, it's become the new attraction in our office. Everybody wants to go fly it, and we have people lining up to go do it. It's a lot of fun, and you really understand the nature of this kind of vehicle when you start doing this work. But I've been thrilled by it, and we're really moving very quickly along learning how to fly it through the simulator work. Next. I wanted to close off by a couple of things. One is that we all have heroes in space, and my particular hero growing up is Alexander Graham Bell. And it's an unusual, perhaps, choice, but I like to talk about him because he's not here to talk about himself. But he is one of the people who had, to me, so much passion in what he did. And he is, in fact, I think, the precursor of this organization, which is a bold statement to make, but Bell did a lot of things. We most know him from his telephone work, but I don't know how many of you know why he invented the telephone. It was out of love. It wasn't out of money. It was out of passion. His mother was hard of hearing, and he happened to marry a woman who was deaf, and he was trying to figure out a way to communicate with her, and that was what drove him to do what he did. And I think very often what we do in space gets driven by passion, not necessarily by money. And as he went on in his career, he was a wonderful guy, and it did many, many things. But he, in many ways, was the father of the aircraft and airline industry. And everybody talks about the Wrights, and I have no objection to them. They were good people. But if it wasn't for Alexander Bell, I don't think we would have had the industry we would have had for a number of reasons. The first was that I want to talk a little bit about partnerships and why that's important. Bell went, he was very curious about flight, and he got engaged with looking at it, and he was just a very smart guy. And he looked at flight, and he went to talk to the Wrights, and he decided he was going to do some work on how to potentially build a flying vehicle. And he wanted to work with them, and they basically, for a lot of reasons, decided they didn't want to work with him. And he was looking at one of their big problems. When they first built their airplane, they could go this way, but they couldn't turn very well. That's a bit of a problem when you're trying to fly an airplane. You do want to occasionally turn and come back and land. The other problem they had was that they weren't able to, once they took off, they needed something to push them to take off. They weren't able to take off and land on their own ability. This was very on in airlines. So he went off to Nova Scotia. If any of you ever get up to Halifax in Nova Scotia, there's a wonderful museum that talks about what I think is the birthplace of American North American aviation. And what he decided to do was to invest his time and money and effort into building an airplane. And he did three things that were really amazing in my view. First, he went out and he brought together lots of really smart young people. And he created the first airline club. It was the first organization that was dedicated to research and development in the airline industry or for airlines. And in his mind, and if you read his writing, it was essentially NewSpace of his day. And he got lots of smart people in a room in a place where nobody really thought anything about him. And almost all those people went on to become fairly famous aviation designers. Probably most notable is Glenn Curtis, who went on to create Curtis and Curtis Wright. And eventually he was the apprentice that was working with Bell. So what did Bell do? I don't know how many of you flew here today, but I did. Every one of us has benefits from what he did. And what he was looking at was how to turn an airplane and how to land and take off an airplane. And the Wrights did something called morphing. They looked at birds and they changed the scope of the wings to try to do that. And that wasn't a very effective way of making it work. Make a long story short, after doing a lot of research and getting rejected by the Wrights, he invented the hinge ailerons and rudders. So everything that we do to turn airplanes from that moment on. So by virtue of his being rejected by people who were sort of being closed-minded about their inventions and what they did, he went off and invented something that has now been on every airplane in the history of aviation. And I wonder who now thinks who's more successful at all doing that. But he also spawned an industry by virtue of having people go off and intentionally trying to start. He was the first XPRIZE. What he did was he created an environment where he had all these smart guys say, I want you to build an airplane, and you're all starting from the same engine. I'm going to give you the engine, and I'm going to make you have a prize, and whoever builds the right design will get a further prize. And he was solving a problem from somebody who was by the name of Langley, if you know that name, eventually came on our NASA center. But the vehicle you see on the bottom here was his invention, and it was the first vehicle that not only turned in flight using hinged devices on the wings, but it was also the first airplane to do a touch and go. It was able to fly, come back, land, and then take off again. And virtually everything that came out of the airplane wound up in a group of these young designers. He gave it to them to go forward, and they built an industry out of it. And I say that for a reason, because I think right now where we are, there's a lot of people who are expressing a lot of angst about how we work together. And I want to explain a little bit about our company philosophy on the matter. We think three things. One is that nothing that we're doing hasn't been done before in some way, shape, or form. We are what our history has been. We've learned a tremendous amount, certainly from the HL20 and the Langley team that we've worked with, but from the shuttle program. I hear all the time about how the shuttles ended and stopped, and my belief's a little bit different than that. I think the vehicles are not flying anymore, but everything that came out of that program is alive and well, and some of it's transferred over to what we're doing and how we're moving forward. I also think that the life of the shuttle goes well beyond the station. Everybody talks about the station coming down in 5, 10, 15, 20 years, but the science we're getting out of working right now with the Hubble telescope is amazing. And if it was not for the combination of humans, the flying characteristics of the shuttle, and a lot of smart people at NASA, we wouldn't have that. And as I mentioned earlier, there is now a million images have come off of the Hubble telescope, 70% of which were after the Hubble was fixed. And I don't know how many more are going forward, and whether or not the James Webb telescope gets built or not, think of how important that is. And that was enabled by humans, by a space transportation system like the shuttle, and by a lot of smart people. And we're very proud of that. We started our Dream Chaser program with the intention, you can go to the next slide, of building not a single company solution, but a team. And a team that's not only one level of companies, but a team that's a level of government and industry and education systems and a lot of smart individuals. And what we are well in the way of doing is creating that team. I'd like to think of it as America's team, but I'm a little bit proprietary on that. What you see here is a map of where we are now, and the map will grow. And we now have engagements with 9 or 8 NASA centers. A couple of them are in the final works of coming together. And our view with NASA is that NASA is a partner. It's a partner who's provided us some capital to move forward. It's also a partner who's providing us a lot of knowledge and a lot of experience and a lot of know-how. And we've reached back and set up Space Act agreements where we're actually hiring and using facilities and bringing and working with the centers around the country which are amazing to us. It's been a terrific, terrific experience. We started with Langley a number of years ago. We added Ames, was our second partner now almost 4 or 5 years ago. And we have a footprint and relationships with all the smart people in virtually all the centers, major centers around the country, with a couple more to come. We also reached out to industry, and this idea that commercial industry can't build a spacecraft like our Dream Chaser is ridiculous in my mind. Commercial industry has been building every spacecraft that's ever flown. It's just a matter of how it's being contracted and who owns it. And to that point, the people that we have on our team, from small companies to large companies, people like Boeing Phantom Works in California, and people like Draper Labs, who've been on virtually every major space program since there's been human spaceflight, and USA, who's doing operations for us, and McDonnell Detweiler, who's working on some robotics work and making the vehicle potentially a servicing vehicle. We also reached out to organizations that are doing ECLS, people like Hamilton and Orbitech, who are part of this group. And the team is not easy to manage. It's a large group of people, but we are the beneficiaries of this huge knowledge base of how to do things the right way. NASA people on the inside, NASA people on the outside, NASA and contractors and commercial companies who are all invested helping us to build this vehicle. And it's been a terrific, terrific experience for us. We also have universities, and part of my philosophy when we started this is that we were going to take a portion of our program and drive it into the university systems. And I tell you, I did it mainly when I started because we wanted to have a lot of young people experience what it would be like to help build a spacecraft like this. And that's been the case. We've got a lot of wonderfully active, energetic graduate and undergraduate students who are part of the program. But we've gotten a lot more out of it than we've ever put into it. I go back there and I see the energy levels that are infectious. And I realize every time I do this why we are in the space industry. The same thing that these kids feel was what I felt when I first started. And the idea that we're getting much more out of that energy and that belief than they ever have. It's been terrific for us. Next slide. Before you start the video, if you would, the title here is The Past is Prologue, and it's a favorite expression of mine. It's actually on the inside of the Jefferson Memorial. It's a historic expression, and basically what it means is that what has happened before will happen again, and what you learn from the past, you'll learn again. And I've got just a short video here that highlights something that we've been wanting to do for a long time. We have, as been mentioned, we were the beneficiaries of a lot of good work that started at NASA in the HL20 program. And a number of years ago, I began realizing that every time I got up and talked, somebody in the audience came up to me and said, I've worked on that program. It was amazing. It made me excited. It was one of those things we've always wanted to do, and we're all about passion in our company. And as this happened, I get more and more calls, letters, and I could tell how old the person was because I got handwritten letters, I got faxes, and I got emails, and then I've got something to our Twitter accounts, and it was basically, you could see the age and the history of the person. But after a while, we realized that it's not something that has never happened, is to go back and say thank you to those people and to express the appreciation that what they are is helping us be something in the future. And we recently had the opportunity working with the folks at NASA and down at Langley Center to invite all those folks back who worked on this program. And we had a great opportunity. It was like a high school reunion in some ways. People drove from all over the country, hadn't seen each other, some of them for 20, 25 years. And basically all we did was say thank you. And in preparation for that, we wanted to put together a little video for them that we've not shown publicly yet, but we did show at that event, which was a little bit of the history of where our vehicle came from, where we are now in terms of the build and the development, and what we expect to do in the future. And then we'll run this, and then if we have time, I'll take any questions. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Yeah, I don't know what our timing is like, but I'll be happy to take any questions if we have time. No, but I contacted them. Yeah, I had the opportunity to go over there, and went back and researched, and we found 3 of the 5 chief engineers, actually, 2 of which were very open, and it was a fun experience because we actually got to get their notes, and I have a copy of the notes from the Russian general who worked the program. It was called the Bor 4 program at that time, and Boron was the company. And what was most interesting, I think, for those of you who are Tom Clancy novel fans, was that this program came about, as someone mentioned earlier, because there was an Australian P-3 spy plane that was flying over the Russian trawler, and you saw an image of something coming out of the water in the video that was being hosed down. And the spy plane took about 20 photographs that it didn't know what it was supposed to do, sent it to the CIA, CIA sent it to NASA, and it was eventually reverse engineered. Well, I went to Russia, I actually got pictures from these people who took me to the warehouse where all this stuff was done. It was a soldier on the Russian trawler taking a picture of the spy plane that was going by. So I felt at that moment I was on the right track with this program. I had my symmetry going on. It was quite a lot of fun. And I told them, as I told the HL-20 folks, that I'm carrying their name with us to orbit because we owe them the same kind of gratitude. They didn't know it at the time, but the most important thing they said, that no one has ever came to them and said, we're going to fly. And it didn't matter I was an American 20, 30 years after they did. They just wanted to know that we were going to fly. And I'll finish that story for a moment. I got a note from the daughter of one of the guys who died since I went there. And she said one of the last things she wanted to, that he wanted to do is have her send me a letter reminding me of the promise I made to put his name on the Dream Chaser when we flew. And that's, I think, what the space industry is all about, in my view. Any other questions?
Does the Dream Chaser use the same engine as Spaceship Two?
It uses the same technology, but a different, a smaller version of the engine. It uses 2 of the engines. They are a little bit bigger, about the same size as the Spaceship One motors that we use, but it's basically the same technology. And that's an important part as we look at heritage. We have a system in the Atlas V that's flown a lot. We would have had a lot of flight experience working with the testing that's going on for the Virgin Galactic program. And all these things build up the heritage and essentially enhance the ability for us to get flying as soon as possible.
What's your expected turnaround time between flights?
We don't have the exact turnaround time, but the idea here is that the vehicle is first highly reusable. It is meant to do that. It's made out of composites, and we're going to have multiple in the fleet, so we can actually have vehicles either purposely built for one direction or another. But the main thing that needs to be determined on the vehicle is we have to refuel the engines, which are not a real big deal because they're a cartridge system, and we have to make sure that the vehicle didn't experience any degree of issues coming in. We carry no hazardous material on board. Unlike the shuttles, there's no hypergols or anything like that. So the vehicle, you can actually go right up to it as soon as it stops its roll and begin the work and doing all the things. You don't have to confine it or handle it in any special way once it's landing. So it will help expedite that.
If you don't use hydrazine, what are you using for attitude control?
We have our RCS thrusters that are actually using ethanol. In the back? Question was why lifting body, and the second question was how fast are we coming in and landing? Lifting body, the use of this vehicle was very purposeful. We looked at a lot of different types of shapes and vehicles, and somebody said earlier it was one that was very stable and had a lot of great characteristics. But to be successful in what we're trying to accomplish, we had to do more than just be able to take crew and critical cargo back and forth to the space station. We wanted a vehicle that could be utilitarian. That sounds like a boring word, but when you're running a business and trying to invest money into this, you want to be utilitarian. You want to be able to have as many possible uses as possible. So we chose this because it was big enough to take 7 crew, and it's big enough to be all cargo. It flies autonomously or piloted. We call it OPV or optionally piloted, so you can go either way with it. And it could stay, it could do scientific, act as a scientific platform autonomously. You can be up on orbit for a long time, weeks, maybe months, to do scientific work and return that scientific work back to Earth, which is a pretty cool thing because you can look at it. And there's a lot of work going into making this a servicing vehicle. So we can do missions similar to what the shuttle did to repair the Hubble, fixing satellites, moving them out of orbit, doing things. And the idea of putting all those things in, which gives us the most opportunity to look at different markets, and that's in addition to taking people to other space destinations if Bigelow gets up to orbit, or just continuing on the work that Virgin might be doing with suborbital by taking some portion of those people into orbital flights. So we have a number of different markets, all of which we wanted to be able to work from the same basic design, and that's why a lifting body. The speed that it comes in, it actually comes in a little bit, about the same speed as the shuttle. It's somewhere in the 185 to 190 range, and it has less than 2 Gs on reentry, which is wonderful, and any of the people on board can go recumbent, which means they can lay down. If you're a long-duration astronaut, you understand the value of that, so you don't have to be sitting up. It's the most comfortable experience, and you're coming in maybe at 1.8 Gs, which is a really big roller coaster, and landing on a runway, and you're able to go right up to the vehicle as soon as it lands. So all these things, as we put them all in the mix, it drove us to this kind of idea, which we feel has the most value in the markets that we're trying to serve.
Yes, by implication, I take it you have a high durability thermal protection system. And
we do have a thermal protection system. We're working with Ames. It's a latest generation tile with an ablative on top, and we're actually looking at being able to replace that thermal protection system as a large group as opposed to tile by tile. So Ames has been a wonderful partner in doing that, and we're trying to use the latest protection system we can.
Is that periodic rather than mission by mission? Or
we think so, yeah. It's a fairly, you have to understand, the vehicle's about 35 feet long, 33 feet long by about 20 feet wide. It has about 1/40th of the surface area of the shuttle in terms of the thermal protection system, so it's not that difficult to manage and work on. The other great thing is because we are doing many of the same kinds of things that the space shuttle did, those people who had those tasks, some of those are coming on board. We need the services of places like Kennedy and all the folks who are doing that kind of processing, and we've begun hiring some of those skill sets to work with us. Yes?
I have one quick question. How many flights do you need to get a return on your investment?
It's a good question. As many as possible is the answer that I usually give. It's sort of interesting because once we build the vehicle, the real cost of getting to space is the rocket. The vehicle is going to have many uses. We don't know how many, but maybe 25 to 50 flights in it. That's about the average of the shuttle did, and we think it could probably be that or more. So the cost of building the vehicle amortized over that many flights is really not that expensive in terms of the space flight activity. It's really the cost of getting to space, as it usually is in most space activities. So it's not as much as we think, as one would think. The rocket for us is what we call a fungible activity. We buy it as we need it. So what we're really doing is spending all our money and all our time investing in the vehicle and investing into integration with the vehicle, with the rocket, and a lot of that has already been invested. Sure. It's where we started, actually. The first thing we did was, could we take this, put it on top of a rocket, and fly it without a problem? And all the work that we've done, which was about 2 years' worth of work done by us, you know, Launch Alliance, as well as two independent groups, came to the conclusion we don't need to be shrouded. The vibration is actually not a problem. It's a lifting body that doesn't actually produce much lift in this configuration until you need it. And it has no particular issues with flying unshrouded. We could fly shrouded if we needed to, but we didn't want to, because that creates more of a challenge in an abort system. So we wanted to try to determine, could we go unshrouded, and there's no reason we can't at all, actually. It works very well.
Hey, Mark.
Hi.
The sort of the holy grail of all of this is full reusability. Is there any path or anything like that that you guys are thinking about downstream where you would get to a fully reusable stack?
You're talking about the vehicle is fully reusable. You're talking about the rocket as well?
The rocket as well.
Right now, we're not working on that. We think if there is, and one of the things that we try to say is that this vehicle is agnostic to launch. We have a great partner and we're working with it, but if United Launch Alliance or someone else were to come up with a different way of getting the space, it's something that we would look at. But no, we're not investing in the reusability of the rocket system. That's, we learned very hard that we stay to do what we know well, and we're not builders of launch systems, and so we stay out of that game.
Did you mention a fleet of these things being built? How many are you considering, if that's true?
Didn't you see them on the pavement outside of Ames? There's a whole bunch of them out there. Yes, I mentioned that. And the idea here is that there will be multiple vehicles, and there's no reason that there can't be. And what the concept is, and I think the reality will be, is that the exterior of the vehicle remained the same. And the model I used was when I went up to Boeing and looked at what they did with their 747, for example. It's one vehicle that can be all crew, it can be all cargo, it can be mission purposed for doing very types of scientific experiments as we've seen. That's what we're seeing with this. If we have the outside vehicle, we know it flies, it can do well, we have a reconfigurable interior cabin, we can create variants of that without a lot of money. One variant might be an autonomous scientific platform for work. Well, there's a little bit of work that needs to be done, but not that much to make that happen. Another variant might be a servicing vehicle where we have an airlock and manipulator arms on it. Well, that's being looked at, it's feasible, there's no reason that we couldn't have that. And so that's what I mean by multiples. And the idea of growing to composite as the primary material in the structure allows us to invest the money in the molds to do the work and then be able to replicate that, not inexpensively, but less expensively than doing fully new vehicles each time.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. I think we got it. So thank you very much. I appreciate it.
All right, before you all run away, I just want to make a few announcements about some events going on tonight. The first one is a Young Professionals Networking Dinner, which will be in the Doubletree Hotel from 7 o'clock to 8:30 p.m. We have several speakers lined up, which are in the addenda. There's also going to be what's called the NewSpace Old Pro Happy Hour, which will run in parallel with the Young Professionals Networking Dinner, which will be in the Doubletree Bar.